right, you're good to start, Xuyang.
Okay, so ready?
Yep.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. I'm Xuyang Zhang, and I'm an environmental scientist at the Environmental Monitoring Branch of DPR. Today, I'm going to introduce a new way of querying data from our surface water database by using a web tool called Google Fusion Table. First of all, I'd like to acknowledge that all of the work I mentioned here is done by Keith Starner, a colleague of ours, who just passed away. I'm fortunate enough to have worked closely with Keith on the database, so that's why I'm giving the talk today, not him. Okay, so Keith has updated the database recently with an addition of 39,000 records to the database, and the database now has a total of 384,000 records from 75 different studies. There are 13,000 samples collected between the year 1990 and October of 2010. The database now covers about 900 sample sites located in 50 counties of California. And the newly added records were all water column data. So the sediment data table stays the same. Now we have about 1,800 records from the samples collected up to July 2005. So what is Google Fusion Table? To put it simple, it's basically a database on the cloud. Fusion Table, by definition, by Google itself, is an experimental data visualization web application to gather, visualize, and share larger data tables. So with Google Fusion Table, users can upload data, query them, visualize them with charts and maps, and then share them on the internet. It's still an experimental application. It's very new. The web tool was introduced to the public in 2009, and it's expected to be more and more powerful with new features. So I'm a fairly new user to Google Fusion Table as well. So I'm surprised by how fast they come up with new features. Okay. So let's go online and take a look at the database and the fusion table. I assume most of you know how to get to the surface water database, but if you don't, this is how I often get the link. If you go to DPR's web page, you see a database tab on the right-hand side. If you click on that, scroll down near the bottom, you see the surface water link. This is the web page to our database. And there's a general description of the database which tells you how many records we have and how recent the data is in the database. And there's this link that accesses the data. So if you click on this one, there are a few different links here. There's the general description, again, just like the same in the previous page. There's the metadata for studies in the database. If you click on this one, it'll go to a PDF file. This file contains a detailed description of all the studies that we got our data from. And sometimes we provide the web link to the study, so you can look, read the reports or the papers online. Okay, so there's a link that guide to query the data. It's a little document tells you how to use Google Fusion Table. You can follow the guide here, and it's pretty straightforward. It tells you how to query the data using Google Fusion Table. And there are two very important links here. One is called Query Surface Water Monitoring Data, and the other is query sediment monitoring data. So these two links are the links to the Google Fusion table, one for the water column data, the other for the sediment data. So I'll go back to the two links later. I just want to show you that there are other links here. This one is called Serve April 2013. It's actually the entire the table of the water column data. So you can, if you want to have the whole database, you can just click on the link and download the entire table, and you can import into your Access or Excel. It's just it's really huge, so it won't work in older version of Excel, which has a maximum limit of 65,000 records. But if you have Office 2010 or later, 2007 or later, you can do that. It just takes a long time to import. And here's another link called Map of all the surface water monitoring sites. If you click on this one, it leads you to an online map of all the sample sites that we include in our database. So, for example, you can zoom into the map and find the area of your interest. And if you are interested in a particular sample site, you can click on the dot here. For example, this one, it's a monitoring site located in Sacramento, and it tells you the site code here, which is exactly the same site code in the surface water database. So you can use this one to query the data for this particular sampling site. It also tells you that there are a total of 743 records, water column records in the database. It shows you the latitude and longitude. So if you are interested in a particular monitoring site, this is a great tool for you to find more information about this sampling site. Okay, so let's go back to the Fusion table. Remember that there are two links to each of the table. You can just click them. And the layout will look exactly the same for these two tables. So one is for the water column records. The other is for sediment. Here you can tell that there for water column table is huge. We have 384,000 records here. And if you look at the sediment table, it tells you how many records we have here. So for the demonstration purpose, I'll just use our water column table. And the layout and everything would be the same for both tables. So if once you know how to query the water column table, you know how to query the sediment table. This is the layout which they call the classic look. This is how the Fusion table looks when it first came out. But later, the develop team creates something new. So there's a tab here, is that switch to new look. So if you switch to the new look, the layout becomes a little bit different, but all the tools in the classic look are included in the new look. So I normally use the new look because, you know, it has more advanced features for query. If you look at the web page here, it tells you the name of the table is, you know, provided by the person who uploaded it. So I just name it Serve April 2013, and it tells you when it was imported into Google Fusion table and who owns the data. And here are the main menus here. On this tab tells it's a file. So here you can share your table. You can create a new Fusion table yourself. You can open files here, make a copy, and you can read about the attributes of the table. You can even merge the table if you have you'll have another table, say, which has common features. For example, if you have another table with the column called county here, you can merge that table with this one. So you can also find a table to merge with. There are some tables that are available to the public online. So you can, if you know the name of the table, you can find them. You can create a view which allows you to narrow down the table. Say here we have quite a few data fields here, and if you don't want this many, you can just select a few columns of your own interest. For example, now currently the water column table contains the county, the site, chemical name, the concentration, the level of quantification, the date the sample was collected, latitude and longitude of the sample site, the time it was collected, and the study code and site code. So there are many fields. Maybe you don't want that many information. So you can go to here and create a view, and then you can just select the fields that you are interested in. For example, I just want the county site and the chemical name. I really don't want level of quantification, and I don't care about the sample time. I don't care about the site code. Or study code. So you can just select the ones that you want, and then you say create. This way it creates a subset of your data and gives you a more narrowed down information, so you don't need to care look at the other fields that are not relevant to your interest. Okay. This takes a little while because the table is huge. Okay, so it says view created. You can view the table or you can just close it. So if you view it, you can see that there are many, the fields that you just removed do not show up here anymore. Okay, so I'm just gonna close this one. So we're going to work with the original table, so it gives you more options to query data. Here, I just want to show, start the query with a very simple one. Let's see, maybe you're just interested in a particular sample site, and then you want to query, like, for example, if you just want to get the data for that particular monitoring site. This is a very good way to start with. I recommend you to start this with, if you go to the map that I just showed you before, you can click on the site that you are interested in, and it tells you the site code is 34_7. So here, if you go to the surface table, surface water table, you can see that there's a site code column here. So to query data, basically, we use the filter tool here. So if you click on the edit here, I'm sorry, the tool here, it gives you a summarize tool, which allows you to summarize the result. But the filter tool is here. It's directly showing here so that you can, it's more straightforward to users. So if you click on the filter here, it automatically generates a list of data fields that you have in your table. So here, remember we are just interested in that sample site. So you can say filter by site code. And see, this is a drop down. The program automatically generates a list of site codes that are included in the database. So you can choose to click on one of the site here. For example, if you select this one, it even tells you how many records are for that sample site. So it tells you there are 236 sample sites at the site located in Alameda County. let's say if you don't want this and it takes, you know, it's kind of difficult to screen, go through each of the site code, you can just type in, if you know the site code, you can just type in here. So we had 34_7, right? So you can go and find this one. And remember, when you look at the map here, it tells you that there are 743 water column records. You can confirm that by looking at the results of the query. Yeah, here it comes. It tells you there are 743 records, and it gives you the result here. And let's say if you want to narrow it down, if you're interested in a particular chemical here, you can click on the filter here again, and you query by chemical. So again, the program automatically generates a list of chemicals that's in the database. So it tells you there are 743 records, and within that 700 or so records, there are this many chemicals. And you can, if you know a chemical of your interest, you can also search it here, or click on the box here. So let's say if I'm just interested in simazine, okay, you don't even have to type the whole name. It'll pop up here, and you can say find. So there are four records of simazine in this particular monitoring site. You can even query query more chemicals here. Let's say if you're interested in, besides simazine, you're also interested in other chemicals, you can type in more here. Let's say atrazine. See if there's any records about atrazine in this site. Looks like no. Okay. So, but anyhow, you can do multiple queries here. And if you want more chemicals, you can keep typing the name of the chemical here, and you can just do query for not only one chemical but also other chemicals. And it also shows you the SQL query code here. You can see the query site code contains, also ignoring the case, the site code equals to 34_7 and chemical equals to simazine. Okay, so you can clear the filter by click on the cross sign here. And if you click that, you'll go back to the original table, which contains all the information here. Okay, there's another example. You can do, sometimes we are interested in a particular chemical, and then you want to look see how often the chemical is being detected. Okay, so let's try a chemical here, maybe chlorpyrifos. And you can do a chemical here, say chlorpyrifos, and find. So it tells you there are about 11,000 records for chlorpyrifos in the entire state. And if you want to know how often the detection is, you can do another filter by concentration here. So note here it says values from 0 through 3.96, which means the maximum detected concentration for chlorpyrifos in the state is 3.96 ppb. So it's a lot of information you can see here. Let's say I just want the detections. I can do the queries by concentration that's larger than one. So I can type in here 0.001. And you can type in a maximum here, but here I don't need to do that. So basically I want all the records that have detections of this chemical. So I click on find, and it tells me that throughout the state there are about 2,400 records that has a concentration greater than zero. And that's out of 11,000. So you can do the math here, do a calculation, and you can see that the percent of detection is about 19%. It also tells you the maximum concentration here, and maybe you want to know where the high concentration is being detected. So maybe you want to just do a query for the records that has concentration higher than 3. Okay, you can do a query. You can do a query here. Okay, and it tells you that the high concentration is were detected in one is in Merced County, one is in Monterey, and the highest is actually detected in Monterey. And let's see, it tells you the sample date on July 21st, 2003. So there's a lot of information you can do here, you can generate here by using the filter tool. You can filter by other fields. I'll just show another simple example, then I'll tell you how to download the data for yourself. So maybe if you're just interested in one county, so you see the highest concentration for chlorpyrifos is detected in Monterey County. So maybe you just want to know the records for Monterey County. So we can remove, maybe we can remove the concentration filter here, and then you can do a query by Monterey, okay. So these are all the records for chlorpyrifos detected in Monterey County. So, and then you can even download the data. So just to show you how to download the data, maybe I want to clear this and think about another chemical of your interest. Maybe how about malathion? Okay, you can say find, oh, sorry. This is malathion. I can just define here. Okay, so you're querying for malathion, and there are about 12,000 records of malathion in this database. Okay, sorry, it's updated, so it's working. It was working there, so there are a total of 9,000 records for malathion. And you can download the data to your local computer, to your local drive, and then you can just manipulate or do analysis on your own. So here, you can click on the file, and you can download the data. Okay, so you can select to download all rows, basically that's the original table, or you can select to download the filtered rows, which is the query result. And you can export as CSF format or KML format, and then you can download the data to your drive. I want to save it. Okay. So you see a new data table. All the Google Fusion table generates the file name by itself. So it always named the table with the original table name and then with the word filtered. So you can rename it by yourself so it's more clear to you, maybe malathion. And then if you take a look at the table, go down, you see there are 9,761 records here. Okay. And so later, I'm going to show you how to upload this table back to your Google Fusion table, and then you can make charts and maps here. So I want to add a new field here. Let's say I want to add a year so that I can make charts to see the yearly trend, okay? So this is the year when the sample was taken. And then I can save the table here. And then I can go back to Google Fusion table. Remember in the file here, there's something called new table. So you can go to the new table here. And then from your local computer, you can upload the table that you just downloaded. It's the Malathion. Okay. So click on, it's a comma, it's a CSV file, so it's comma delimited. It's loading. Okay. So sometimes if your data does not contain a column name, you can say none, or you tell, in this particular case, the column name is on the first row. So you can say one here, and you can click on next, and you can name it. I'll just leave the name Malathion there. You can put the description there for the table so that you know what it is about. And also, you can, if you have a page link, you can provide it here, and also the detailed description. So I'll just leave them blank there, and then I just say finish. So it says your data is being imported. If you have a large table, it takes longer, but it's not that bad. So to save time, I actually have Malathion, the same query table in my Google Drive already. So whenever you upload a table or you have something in Google Fusion table, if you log into your Google account, you see the files you have here. So I log into my Google account, and here are a list of tables I have here. So Malathion, you can see Malathion is here. Then I can click on the table here. Okay, and basically this is exactly the same layout as the water column table that I just showed you. So I just introduced the features under the file menu, and also the filter menu, which allows you to query the data. And there are other tools in Google Fusion table as well. Added is basically for the table owners. So I'm the owner of this table because I just uploaded it. So I can just add more rows or delete rows or add columns so I can manipulate the table. But if you share the table with somebody else and you don't want other people to mess up with your table, you can define it as private so that other people won't be able to change the table. And you can click on the help here, which provides many additional information, which you can learn more about Google Fusion table. And here you see there are a few different tabs here. The first one called rows. Basically, there are different layouts of your table. So if you click on rows, it's in the traditional layout. If you click on the card, it's kind of interesting. So it'll generate each individual records in like a name card format. I found this is not quite useful in our case, but maybe other users would find this interesting. So I'll use the rows layout. And here it tells the map of county. So the mapping tool in Google Fusion Table is not very mature yet, so you have to use it with caution. Sometimes the geocoding is not correctly made, so you see something like a side being off. But anyhow, it's a tool there, and it's good to use if you just want to see, like if you know the area and you want to explore the data a little bit more. So if you click on the map of county, it shows you all the sample size for malathion, so in the data. You can zoom in and zoom out. So basically, this is an example of how unreliable the geocoding can be. If you click on one sample set here, you can click on any of the dots. It'll automatically show you all the information about that record. So this is actually, it says it's in Nevada County, but the geocoding was wrong. So the site would be located in the state of Nevada. But I can tell that most of the sites were geocoded correctly. So if you click on, let's say, the Sacramento area, if you click on this one, it says Sacramento River at Freeport. So I know this area, and I know this one is being geocoded correctly. Anyhow, I think the map tool, I think they will continue working on this one and make it better. So it's still experimentary and still with some error. But you can use this tool to explore the sample size for the data you have. And the chart tool, this is for you to make charts here. So if you click on this one, the program automatically gives you some templates, the chart templates. So in this case, you can do a chart by dots of, this is level quantification. I just want a concentration of malathion for all the records. And here you can change what you want to put in your x-axis. The y-axis is the concentration here, and here I want to put a year as x-axis. So this is this can show you the concentrations that for malathion, and it gives you basically a yearly trend. And you see in 2010 there's a very high detection there. And the line graphs are basically similar. You can also do a bar chart. And this is something that's very interesting. You can do a summarize the data chart here. So for example, if you want to see the detections by county, you can do category as county here. And you can click on summarize data. So you can do count, which is the number of records for that county, or you can do the maximum or minimum concentration. This shows you the maximum concentration detected by county. And pay attention to this one here. It says maximum categories. So if you have 10 here, it only shows 10 counties there. I'll just make it 50. See there, so all the counties for that data will show up here. And you can do a sort by maximum concentration. And you can do reverse, so it'll maybe I'll remove count so that you can see better because they're not in the same scale. Okay, so it'll sort the maximum concentration by county. So you can tell Monterey County has the highest maximum concentration, followed by Santa Barbara and then Calusa. So I think it's a very interesting tool, and it provides you some simple tools for you to explore the data a little bit more. But as always, you can download the data yourself, and you can open the data in Excel, and you can make analysis, make charts. At this stage, I would recommend you to make charts in Excel rather than using the online tool, because sometimes it's not that reliable yet. And if you click on the, this is a very interesting, you can do pie charts here. As a user, you have limited options in terms of what you can do here because you have what they provide here. But actually, they have something called Google Fusion API. They are for more advanced users who are developers. So they can write Java or Python code to query and make layouts and manipulate the web page themselves. But for general users, you are limited by what they provide here. So I would not recommend you if for scientific purpose don't use the chart for publication. You can always download the data, which is really straightforward, and you can do it in Excel or other statistical tools of your own. Okay. Those are basically all the features they have here. If you click on the plus sign here, you can add different layouts here. You can add a summary. You can add charts and add maps. So here I think I want to talk more about how you can summarize the data online. This is a very reliable tool. So I've been testing this a lot, and I know the summary tool works correctly. So if you want to go back to your original data, let's say you can click on the rows here, and then maybe, for example, we want to summarize the malathion data by county. You can, if you click on the drop-down menu here, this summarize, you can do summarize here by county. And you can add another one. Let's say not only county, but I want to do it by site. Or maybe by year. That's probably better. And then you can summarize the concentration. It'll automatically generate the count for you. So in addition to the concentration, there's always a count. You can choose maximum, minimum, or average. I just select whatever I want. And then I say save. So this is a summary table. I found this is really useful for me. It's just like the PV table in Excel. But if you don't want to download and importing in Excel, you can just do it here with a few clicks. So it summarizes by county and year and the number of records here, minimum, maximum concentration, and the average concentration. So I found this is a very useful tool. Summarize table and also query the table you want. Okay, that's all I have. Oh, to remove the, if you want to go back to your original table, you can click on summarize again and say clear summary. So once you clear the summary, it'll return to your original table. Okay, that's all I have for about the Google Fusion table. If you have any scenarios or any kind of queries you want to make, this is the time, and then I can show you how I can do the query. Do you have any ideas or any scenarios that you want to do?
Hey, Xuyang, I have a quick question about, can you put in, when you're filtering for concentrations, does it recognize greater than or less than symbols?
Oh, you want to query the concentration greater than a particular value?
Yeah, instead of like, because if you didn't know the minimum value for detection, can you just put greater than zero?
Yeah, it's so you can click on concentration here. There's no greater sign. It always asks you for a range, but you can always do 0.0001. So in the essential, you're asking for records that's greater than zero. And you can define here. It tells you the range here. The records has concentration values from 0 through 22.5.
Right,
so you know the range of concentration.
But it could potentially be a value less than 0.0001.
There's no. Normally you can increase this to really you can do like 8 decimal places. We don't have those many decimal places in the surface water database. So either one or I believe is 0.01. If you do like 0.001, basically you're asking for values that's greater than 1. Would that work for you?
Yeah, I'm just asking if it recognizes the greater than symbol. So if you want to.
The new look does not, but I believe the classic layout allows you to do that. So maybe we can go back. If you click on help and back to classic look. So the classic look allows you to do that. Basically, let's try it here. View, under view, filter. So you can say concentration. And there's the greater sign here. So you can say greater than zero. And then you can apply. So you see, basically, those are the records with concentration greater than zero. In the classic look, in the old version, it allows you to type in things like that. But the new look does not. But I think we can you can do just what I did, and it'll give you the same results. Okay.
Can you tell us how you did the adding the column with the year?
Adding the column with the year? Okay. I actually did that outside of the Google Fusion table. I downloaded the data to my desktop here in my computer, and then I open it in Excel file. And then I just do insert a column in Excel. So you can always do like add columns here, but I believe once you upload the table in Google Fusion table, you can do that as well. So let's try to see if we can do that. Switch to new look, and in edit, you can add a column here. So if you click on add a column, you can name it. Let's say maybe it's called year 2 or something like that. And you can define whether it's a text or a number. You can do a number. And you can format the number here. Make it like that, and you can entry, you can enter the data there, and it also tells you how to do the data entry. I believe you can type in the numbers there, but I haven't tried that myself because it's longer. So that's why, let's say save. Yeah, it takes a while, but for now, I like to manipulate. Okay, so I tend to add the columns myself in Excel when I prepare my data, so that when I upload into Google Fusion table, I don't have to mess up with the, I don't want to edit the layout of the table. Let's see if the, okay. It actually doesn't show up here. I don't know why, I'm sorry. You can add a formula column. Excuse me. Let's see, new calculated column and formula. You can try to do a formula. You can try to type a formula here. Maybe we can, but I never try to do that myself because I don't want to mess up with the layout of the table.
Yeah.
If you are more advanced programmer, you can easily do that. You can do a function like Power Base or, for example, you can do, we can do a simple calculation here. Say formula equals plus, if, maybe, concentration plus name of concentration. Dropping items. Let's see. Yeah, I'm not quite familiar with how you insert new columns or insert new rows. I know you can do that there, but it's not very convenient because sometimes, for example, if you want to insert a year, you want to do a formula, you want to do a function to get the year out of the sample date. I would do that. I would recommend do that in Excel at this stage. I don't think the tools there are very advanced yet, which allows you to do that. But if you have a small table, say if you have only 10 records or 20, you can easily type in the values for each row. You can do that. But right now, I recommend you to do that in Excel, and then before you actually upload the data, so that when you upload the data, you don't have to change the layout.
Thank you.
Sure. Any other questions?
Hi, this is Bill Eckel at EPA.
Uh-huh.
My question is about doing co-occurrence analysis. In other words, I would be interested in finding out which stations on which dates have the highest concentrations of malathion, and then going back to those stations and dates and pulling in all the other occurrences of other chemicals to
uh-huh.
see which ones occur together.
Okay.
That easily done here?
I think it's not straightforward, but with a few steps you can do that. So let's query with the malathion table here. You want the maximum concentration and the sampling site, right?
Uh-huh.
So let's say you want to query by concentration, and it tells you the maximum concentration is 22.5. So maybe you want a concentration that's greater than 20, right? Or 25, that's fine. And it tells you that the site is in Alyssa Creek in Monterey County. and it's in year 2008, okay? So, and you want to find out what are the other chemicals that's also occurring at that same location at the same time, right?
Yes.
Okay, so now you know the location about the site, you know the year is 2008, and actually it's in July of 2008. And then, you know, I recommend query by site code so that you don't have to, in terms of monitoring site, I recommend you query by site code, but you don't have to type in this long name, okay?
Right.
So we can query, we can go back to the original surface water data table, and then you query by the site code, which is 27_10, and
right.
You can query by date. Okay, so let's go back to the surface water data table. Remember, this is, we queried Malathon before, so you can cross out the filter. So every time you want to start with the original table, you want to clear all the filters you've made. So now this is the original table. You want to filter by site code, which is 27_10, okay? So you can do 27_10. Okay, so it tells you there are a total of 1,002 records in that particular monitoring site. And you can also narrow it down because you want the chemicals that's occurring at the same time, huh? So we can filter by sample date. So maybe you want to, maybe the samples that's collected in 2008, let's say you can do, you can type in maybe starting summer, maybe May of, May the 1st, 2008 to about August 30, 2008. So, you know, I don't know what temporal range you want to cover, but this is just an example. So you can find all the records within that time frame. So you can see that there are 547 out of total of 1,000 or so records that's showing. Now you have all the records that's taken at the same location and the same temporal range.
Could you sort those?
And you want to find out what are the chemicals, right?
Yeah, could you sort those by concentration, the concentration PPB column?
Okay, the concentration, you want to query concentration that's greater than zero or?
Greater than point many zeros, one.
Okay, so we can do concentration that's greater than 0.1.
Make it 4 0 1.
4 0 1. 4 0 0 0 1. Oh, 0.001. Okay. So now we further narrow it further down to 91 records. Okay. So you want to have a list of the chemicals. We can do a summarize. We can do a summary here. Oh, sorry. Summarize, and you can summarize by chemical, and then you can show, you want to show maybe the concentration, always maximum, minimum, or average, and then you can save it here. Okay, so those are the chemicals that co-occurring with malathion. Actually, malathion is one of the chemicals here. So you can tell the number of records for that chemical, the minimum concentration, maximum concentration, and also the average concentration. Would this work for you?
It's very close.
Okay. Any additional ideas?
Well, I think we'll need to work on that one, but it's getting to where we want to go, I think. Kind of interested in knowing if on a particular date and time in a particular place, if a single compound results in most of the toxicity in that sample, or if it's more than one that contribute.
Oh, I see. So that, I'm sorry, I don't think we have any toxicity information here.
That's okay. We have the toxicity information.
Oh, okay. So maybe you can compare that with your toxicity results. Or if you have maybe a level of concern, for example, LC50 values, you can compare the concentrations with your LC50.
Yeah, but I wanted to get it down, if I could, say for a single site, sample site, look at the combinations over time.
On combination over time, you wanna, what's your time frame?
Oh, a year, calendar year.
A calendar year. Yeah, we can easily modify that here. Now you have this single site, right? This particular site, and if you wanna over a year range, you can define here with the sample date. Say maybe January 1st of 2008 to December 31st of 2008. You can modify here and do a find. And what's wonderful here is that it automatically updates the summary table for you. And again, you can always go back to the data, the queried results you can download in your file, and you can do further analysis in your own computer.
Cool. All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions and thoughts?
Is it possible to do a 3D graph?
3D graph?
In other words, looking by county and by year and by concentration.
By county, by year, and the concentration. I'm not sure yet, but we can explore it. As I said, you are limited by the number, the choices of chart template you have here. So whatever they provide here, that's all you got.
Okay.
So I don't think there's a 3D option here because there's only one, there's only X and Y axis. There's no Z axis.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions? Folks in the room?
Good on our end.
I don't think anybody else has any questions.
Okay.
Thank you, Xuyang.
Thank you.
Well done.
Have a good day.
Thanks.
Bye-bye.